masters of their own Slav minorities. The Germans in Vienna were jealous. Franz Joseph was to find it increasingly difficult to control their arrogance towards the Slavs in the Austrian half of the empire, above all towards the Czechs in Prague. At the parliament in Vienna, feelings between the races ran high. There was often brawling and even bloodshed. But Franz Joseph was at last learning wisdom. He began to see himself as the father of all his peoples. And his peoples included Slavs, as well as Germans, as well as Magyars. Having started as a tyrant, he'd come to see his duty as a protector, enabling all to live in concord and peace. It was the only real solution at the time. Many of them knew this themselves. They knew that this extraordinary mixture of races scattered over Central and Southeastern Europe couldn't survive without a supranational regime to hold them together. When the Habsburgs had gone, they tried to live alone, but failed. First Hitler, then Stalin moved in. Vienna was never more beautiful than when it was dying. Franz Joseph had been on the throne 19 years, 19 years of disappointments and failures. No empire in decline has yet produced a visionary. Franz Joseph was above all an administrator, and as such he continued to work with all his devotion and energy. In the Austrian half of the empire, the rigid apparatus of government could be relaxed now that the Hungarians had self-rule. The year after the Battle of Sadowa, a waltz was commissioned from Johann Strauss to raise Austria's spirits. The Blue Danube was immediately hailed as a second national anthem. And after the first shock, defeat itself came to be regarded as a liberation, as an invitation to light-hearted cheerfulness. The Great Exhibition of 1873 was a triumphant display of the empire's wealth and yet another excuse for gaiety. Vienna launched on a program of rebuilding and expansion, which in 30 years was to transform the face of the city and turn it into one of the most beautiful in Europe. The magnificent Ringstrasse, a great circular boulevard, was a street to celebrate the apotheosis of an imperial tradition. It was, in fact, its mausoleum. Some people sensed this, most did not. This was the period of the great Vienna legend, the Vienna of glittering society, of brilliant uniforms and enchanting girls. Joseph's capital was so hectic it was thought to be decadent, and in a way it was. But behind the splendid parades of wealth and beauty